Welcome, Hordlings, to an introductory of Might and Magic 3, A Passage Through the Isles. I got this document from replacementdocs.com. However, I do own the original manual and game, so I am totally within my legal rights. What this video is going to be is a complete dialogue of the manual itself to kind of transition and open up the plot, perspective, characterization, and depth of the new Might and Magic game itself. So if you don't give two shits about the backstory, the plot, or any of what is leading up to the game itself, then by all means, skip this video. Go straight to video one. This is video zero. But all this video is going to be is a literal narration of the manual itself with my sexy ass voice. Might and Magic 3, A Passage Through the Isles. The Journal of Korak the Mysterious.
I am Korak, called the Mysterious, and these are my scribblings as I journeyed across the Isles of Terra in search of a forgotten lore. Take them as an aid in the adventure before you, for these isles are not all seem to be, and beyond the shroud of legend, truth is often seen.
From the corners of the misty void rang loud the battle cry. The elemental lords of Fur had sworn to fight and die. Fire, water, air, and earth didn't meet their might and force, and in the bladder's bloody mire found our land its source. And in the battle's bloody mire found our land its source. Okay, sorry about that. Fuck that up. The second day of the new moon, 491, in the town of Wildebar. It's been 4 years since last I set out to explore a new land and discover the hidden lore and fables surrounding its towns and castles. The swelling of spirit brought about by telling of these stories of heroism and bravery beyond hope is the thread of magic woven in minds and hearts of all who long to answer the call of adventure. And it is for this purpose to preserve the magical spark that I have devoted my efforts to recording these tales. From the rumors and murmuring I have heard passing through Wildebar, these isles are rich with such histories. While talking to a town elder, he told me of an ancient rhyme, once read before festivals and contained the legend of the mysterious conception of the isles. A legend that today circulates across the land, but altered through the years since the original scroll's disappearance. He read to me a portion he recorded before the original vanished, and told me what he could remember of the rest of the tale. Other parts, he said, may be recorded across the islands. The epic was written in three parts, and the fragment he gave me was from the first, in which it contained an account of the birth of the Isles out of a great battle between powerful lords of the four elements, who used fire storms to fight the supreme control for the void. A place where there was no land or sky or ocean, water and fire, air and earth met in this empty void to fight for the right to fill it with their presence. But so much matched were they in battles, none could defeat the others, nor could they any stop fighting, lest their balance be upset, and he be overrun by others. They had become locked in an eternal war none could turn away from, and as the war raged on through the decades, in the midst of the void, where the fallout of the mighty storms gathered and the settled, a rich land began to develop. From where, no one knows, but beasts appeared to graze the fields of a new land and take refuge in the forests and caverns. Little notice did the elemental lords pay to these dumb beasts, for there was little threat in their roamings. They were seen as nothing more than flies that gather around a fallen animal. And so the war raged on with intensifying storms that added to the richness of the budding land. But then a new creature mysteriously appeared in the void. Not dumb like the beast, but clever in ways of cultivating the raw loam of the battlefield further into a rich provider of food and shelter. Difficult and costly, though it was in the midst of the furious storms of battle, a continent was forged in the misty void. In the forests and valleys settled the spry creatures of great intelligence. Thin and strong, the elves were quiet at home amongst the trees and fields of green. Though weaker in endurance than some, they were possessed of a high aptitude for the magical arts and resistance to its power and energy. And in the snowy areas, the bitter cold found the gnomes their home. Like the elves, they were strong of mind, not body, and little more prone to the ways of magic. But unlike the brooding elf, the gnome was very jolly and quick to make friends. Because of the harshness of their snowy land, their continent was toughened to the elements, and even more so to magic. Sojourned in the desert sun, the dwarf, small but mighty, they survived in the turmoil of the stormy war, for little of the elemental realm could do them great harm. After all, it would take a strong creature to find a thriving life in the lands of sand. With little overpower of magic, dwarves found their strength in the solitude among the dunes. And in the swamps and bogs settled a tribal people of great strength and endurance. So strong were they, the fire, electric, and cold could hardly harm them. Because they lacked the greatness of mind for magic, they had to rely on their ability to fight and survive. And that ability was developed to great heights, for the half-orc lived for battle and saw the opposing of men as great endeavors.
Hello, my name's Luglug.
But scattered across the many diversities of the newfound land, humans wandered and made places for themselves among all others. Able to resist all elements of magics and learned in the ways of mystical arts, they were well equipped to settle where they wish. Soon they thrived across the land, and with the others began to tame the beast and cultivate fields. With the arrival, these conquerors of the land, the elemental lords, realized that while they fought amongst themselves, the very prize for which they were slain was being taken away from them by little mortal beings who in their eyes were no better than the dumb beast. Each would try to vanquish the mortals with a great storm, but because they could not remove too much of their force from the war, the mortals were able to withstand them. In fact, the storms of the elementals were less severe than the effects of the war itself. So the elementals had to find another way to purge the void of these intruders. So an agreement was made to halt the fighting for one day and devote all their powers to create one great tempest of such destructive power that none could withstand it even for an hour. Air gathered tougher than the strongest of its winds to blow the sands of earth with such force as to tear away the flesh from mortal bone. The center of the void where fire would bake the mire into solid stone. Even combined in total unity, the mortals could not survive a day of such torrent. So little hope was there in the darkest hours before the great destruction. All merely stayed in their doomed homes, and the helplessness in their hearts made the greatest cry for mercy any world has ever known. The fourth day, the new moon in 491, the quest begins. After searching for the right opportunity, I finally found a group to set across the isles with in search of lost parts of the legend. A band of four fighters and a healer have enlisted me as their mage, not knowing the fullness of my power. We are to travel to Swamp Town and receive a scroll, which we will deliver to the Fountainhead. The leader of the party, Asamil Chima, has agreed to take a circular course to allow me a wider search of the lost pieces. We'll be traveling across most of the islands, skipping only the smaller ones. I will be receiving a smaller share of the reward for delivering the scroll, but it is the search and hopeful discovery of the forgotten lore that calls me to adventure, not the promises of wealth. Assuming all is to be in order, we will set out tomorrow for the Isles of Illusion, where I will search the two castles said to be laid out in the ruins upon the sand. From there, it will be traveled to Buzzard Bluff, where we will camp for the night. The next day, we will journey through the Evermoors and north to the Swamp Town, find the scroll, and most likely spend a pleasant night at a local inn. From there, I will lead the expedition to Serpent's Wood, the original settling place of the dwarves, and on through the Frozen Isles, where we will camp a second night. Then, we will go to Leopard Cabin, and straight to Fountainhead. 4 days they plan, but it will likely extend to double. The fifth day, 491 setting off. Sorry about the resolution, it got shitty. Today, after much preparation, we started our journey across the Isles of Terra. This group I joined is far more powerful than I had earlier believed. Rather than renting a boat as I had thought we would, the healer Rafa stood at the water's edge, where the earth meets the ocean, and stretched her arms wide. All was still for a moment, and then strange winds blew from the corners of a rope, and that seemed to be a disturbance in the waters. Fog rolled in thick and choking, and in the midst it appeared a ghostly galleon riding on swelling waves. It was truly an impressive sight, and a little unnerving too. The ghost ship took us across the waters to the closest of the Isles of Illusion, where we are now resting, entering the castle rooms. But I still don't know where it came from or where it returned, for as soon as westward upon the shore drifted away in the silence of the fog. It's a poor omen when the first battle of adventure ends in death. While searching the ruins of Castle Greywind, we came upon a powerful phantom magic user that had made his home in the rubble. He attacked it once without warning and engulfed Rafa in the pink glow of energy, draining all life out of her. Asa Milchima responded quickly by letting fly a bolt from the crossbow at his side, but it only passed through the apparition. While the other advanced, the ghostly figure summoned a huge and beastly bear. It vanished in a flash of light. Asa Machima and Tsufa the ninja only hurt a little in battle with the beast. But Rafa had been our healer. I did what I could for the others without revealing the full extent of my powers, but the loss of Rafa is most unfortunate. The loyalty of this group is strong, for they plan to spend their part of the reward to have her healed at the temple in Swamp Town. The sixth day of the new moon. We're camping at Buzzard Bluff.
Then descended on the land the forces of the dawn to lend into the mortal land. Before by forces of might and magic, two champions forged by each, 10 heroes made the tale most tragic for the elemental beast.
I tried my best, guys. It's 420. On the dot. There is a dark mood hanging over the camp tonight, darker than the clouds that cloak the moon, darker than the thick limbs of trees that hide untold creatures peering from the outside of the circle of firelight. It has been raining since the middle of day, and falling drops have beaten down the spirits of even our steeds who stand nervously stamping. The fight of yesterday still weighs upon the minds of all, myself included, made heavier by the legend of the winged death, said to prey on travelers of the forsaken sands. I must admit, I will even feel relief when this night is nothing more than a memory. It seems a fitting enough setting to muse upon the peace of a legend I found in the ruins of Castle Greywind. It tells of the intercession of the forces of Dawn, the five forces that gave men the power to overcome the attack of the elementals. Intercession was never good. The Cosmonian was the force which guided the elements and other forms of energy from place to place. Air, water, fire, earth, and electrical energies were commanded and controlled. Esoterica was the power of the inner self, the energy, life, forms of life, with the command of mind and the ability of healing and afflicting. And Gaiam commanded the order of the life in the forest and in the skies, of the trees and the clouds, the manner and temperature, temperament even, of nature, and the wills of beasts bow to the influence. Bellum was the essence of war and violence, which manifested itself into the darker moods of beasts and violent turns of weather, like the storm tonight. And Lurkane, that invisible silent sheet of clandestine power that slipped into the works, into the world unseen. These were the forces that silently watched from their perch above the clouds as the elementals did battle. According to the legend, they never joined the fight, but when they discovered the elementals' plan to destroy all men and beasts, they had pity on the helpless mortals and gave them the secrets of the power to defend their lives. Other tellings of the tale say the forces of the dome feared the elementals, would be so amazed at the strength they possessed. When they joined together, they would unify and attack them in their lofty home, pulling them into a never-ending battle. For whatever reason, the forces taught we mortals of their power, two to each force, and made 10 champions to drive back the elementals before they could pull the ranks together. To the elf, Cosmonium opened the secrets of how elements move through the void, giving total control over fire, cold, energy, and electricity. In padded armor and armed with staff, the first great hero set mastering his control over the elements and created many powerful incantations for the coming battle. He was called a sorcerer. I remember the thrill of discovering the power and beauty of lightning, my personal favorite, and my youth camping on a rainy night with a band of adventurers like this dark evening. I would sometimes fire a bolt at a nearby tree just to startle my companions. An act I'm sure our fallen comrade would strongly disapprove of. And to another of the elfin kin, Cosmonium showed the way to make the shaft of wood travel straight and true to its mark. This was named the Archer, and the gird of armor changed. She was the second of the heroes to emerge. Due to the common origin, she was able to use the spells created by the sorcerer, but only to a limited degree. Most of her energy was spent in the study of the bow. Next, Esoterica took a gnome and trained her in the healing ways, revealing the secrets of the mind, the body, unlocking the power of good or render bad one's constitution. A most powerful hero this was called, the cleric, and her splint mail, helm, and shield to heal the fallen comrade and destroy the weakened foe was her pledge. Another gnome was taken thus and taught healing ways, but much emphasis was also given to the use of weapon and armor. A most noble champion, called Paladin was he, and a frightful foe to face. Clad in the strongest of armor and wielding the weapons of truth and right, he was to become one of the greatest of the legendary figures, inspiring much lore and many followers. The Gaia made its choice to the dwarf to champion its cause. Many languages revealed empathy with the plants and beasts and the patterns of seasons and stars. Secrets of the living land endowed in the smallish figure to command the forces of nature to do her bidding, commanding great storms and flurries, swarms to do battle, but also calling upon natural healing for the nature to help the fallen. As devoted to the land as the cleric to the body, this new one called the Druid would sacrifice her being. And in the orders of nature, in leather the Druid traveled with barely a sword to swing. A storm such as tonight would hardly be worthy of the rattle of such a champion. When the force of Gaiam gave empathy with the force to the dwarven champion, it called the ranger a dark and mysterious one, was indeed created. At home in the denseness of the trees, contended with the thicket of the vines and the cluttering of bushes, the ranger was diverse in the mood, as the forest was diverse in the creatures. Like the first hero ranger, our own Asya is prone to sudden changes in temper, from jovial to impish to condemning and stern. Bellum then chose the half-orc to be champion of the sword. good in the finest of armor, helm, and shield, and with the mightiest weapon trained he is in the arts of war, melee, and valor. Called the knight, he became the strongest of the champions, with the greatest desire to march across the battlefield, while the paladin would seek peace through battle and find victory in the quick end of war. The knight longed for the brotherhood of battle and felt a kinship to all combatants. And the second champion made Bellum to be called Barbarian, for it was not brotherhood she seeked in battle, but the lust of blood. With the greatest endurance of heroes, the Barbarian seeked the thrill of rushing into battle. Clad only in scale armor, she wielded her shield and great hammer against the armies of her foes. And all the statues and tapestries I have seen dedicated to the likeness of this champion, she stands high upon a mountain of fallen warriors, a helm of horns upon her head. Lucane, then, the last and most mysterious of forces, took the two lures to its cause. I was first taught to move in the invisible folds between the places of here and there, and travel unseen and unheard. Known as the robber, he was able to work the mechanisms of locks and traps, hide in the faintest of shadows, and advance upon his foes to deliver a fatal thrust of a dagger in the back. In the mail of chain, with the shield, dagger, crossbow hanging on his side, he moved in the leaves like a feather. And the tenth champion, made for battle, was strong in all attributes of fitness and mind, called the ninja. A most powerful warrior, as she with special weapons created especially for her mastery at arms, a mastery not even thralled by the mighty knight, bound to a life of solitude, alone even among the other champions, her discipline of body and mind consumed every moment. She was called the Silent Warrior, for she possessed the stealth of a robber, even in her chain mail, and was never known to speak. These 10 were the champions of war against the elementals, where mortal man was taught the arts and magic, the ways of war by the 5 forces of the dome: Cosmonium, Esoterica, Gaium, Bellum, and Lucane, the forces that are above the clouds, above the stars, that indeed guide the stars through their journey across the night. Now my time at watch is done, and Sifir comes to relieve me. Tonight I must rest well, for the tomorrow we journey across the Evermoors, and that is no place to be when weary. The 7th day of the new moon, 491 in Swamptown.
Today we arrived in Swamptown after a surprisingly easy journey through the Evermoors. There were only a few small battles along the way as we came across wandering animals and insects. Although the danger was small, it was a good workout, for any small mistake could cost dearly. After entering the west gate of Swamptown and finding the giver of the scroll, we were to take Fountainhead. Rafa was taken to Temple Moonshadow. It was by luck alone that the others barely enough to pay for the service of monks, as the boat was re-rented to carry us from the Forsaken Sands to Evermore, dug deep into our party's pouch. The reward for delivering the scroll will hardly do more than recoup the fees of Rafa's resurrection. With Raffer's return, a room was taken at the inn, where I now sit writing these notes, barely clinging to life, and also very drunk. The others are relaxing, as it were, in the tavern, where they are telling Raffer of all that's happened in the past 2 fucking days. My hopes of finding more of the legend are failing after talking to the others I've met around in town. While visiting the guild, there was one who had just returned from the Frozen Isles, where he had been searching for the rhyme himself. He told me there was no part of it to be found in the northern regions, and he was very happy to see Fragment had returned from the ruins of Castle Greymond. I told him the tale of the Elder of the Wilderbar spoke to me. After the battle and over, the champions had been used the power of the forces of the dome, gave them to drive the elemental lords to the corners of the void. The 5 forces picked up the land that had been in the battlefield and moved it to the heavens, from the gates of the ancient to the gates of Terra, where the land was set in the midst of the water and broken into isles. While the forces will carry in the house of the stars. The Tenios built the towns to protect the people from the monsters and the beasts roam to the land. And they train the others to disable them until they're given the force to start the tradition and skills. It's carried over the present times. Great walled towns were built to provide shelter and protection from the outside wilderness to be a place of haven for those adventurers who traveled across to the new land and tried to tame and conquer its growing life. They were exciting times of adventure and bravery, but there was a need for places of healing and training. So in the towns were raised dwellings where all the services an adventurer needed could be received. There were places of weaponry, houses of ale and feast, five houses of healing, and the mysterious monks who tended them paid homage to the forces for saving them, tending to them. Elementals, grounds for trainings and battle skills, mystical schools for heightening one's magical prowess. Places where wary could rest in safety and store their goods and find the other to replace a fallen companion. It is in these foundations that all town dwellings of today find their source. In the blacksmith shop, workers of steel and iron forge new weapons of destruction and repaired the broken implements of warriors. There was a lucrative trade of wares from many places abroad and all needs of dungeon lurking, such as rope and torch, could be found. It was also a place to find the finest in armor and protective wares, and unknown mechanisms or weapons could be identified, and their uses and value revealed. Of course, the excess in a traveler's pack would bring a decent enough price to pay for a good time in the houses of ale. The inn was a place where the wary could rest behind a locked door and under a roof to protect from falling rain. But the inn was created as more than just a place to take a much-needed halt in traveling for young adventurers seeking the thrill of battle and discovery of untold wealth. Could sign in the registry and wait for the party in need of help to enlist the services. Oftentimes, when enlisting the aid of those you meet roaming the forest and caves and rooms, he will bid you meet him at the inn, where you had registered last before joining on your quest.
Taverns were built where the ale flowed, and profusely as the rumors off the loosened lips of explorers and warriors who came to these rowdy bards for a healing that could not be found in the temple. It was a place where gold put in hand of the barkeep might reveal the clue to find unspeakable treasure and fortune. And when adventurers' pack ran low on food, it could be filled with the specialty of the house. After all, when one's strength runs low, resting is of little avail when there's no meal to replenish the flesh.
And for the fallen and injured warriors, temples of healing were erected to the forces of the dome. Five forces gave mortals the power to subvert the deluge, and five temples were constructed to honor the powers and help those who fell in their service. Warriors with the affliction could find cure from mysterious monks that tended these sacred shrines. Flesh would be restored and curses lifted, and it was believed that special blessings awaited those who donated a portion of their booty to these shrines. But those portions of gold and treasure that were not donated to sacred monks were in a constant threat of becoming another's booty, so the builders of the towns made a sturdy and secure cage and commissioned strong golems to guard it. The bank was needed to keep one's wealth in safety. Because there were even excited days following the victory over the elementals, those who would feed on the weaker but more fortunate of their fellow man. Though Fallaby secure from the theft, the bank was safer than the skin tents of the adventurers' camp. To train others in the way shown to them by the forces of the dome, the 10 champions also made great training grounds with tracks and arenas and all manner of devices for improving strength and stamina. For a price, any adventurer who had come from a long quest or journey could seek the help of a specialist in all the arts of battle
to advance in the skills of swordplay, archery, and all methods of melee. A person's stamina and endurance in battle could also be enhanced by the techniques of the master of the ground. For those who study magical arts, mysterious guilds are built to train the magic user to control the forces. Through intense study, deeper control of one's chosen way could be gained, and new incantations purchased to expand the mage's abilities and arsenal of spells. There are places of great secrets, and none but the members of each guild could enter. Legends of the surrounding area were written in the history of each guild to provide helpful hints and warnings to the wise. And thus, that leads us to the 8th day of the new moon, 491, the Frozen Isles. Tonight we are camping in the chilly environs of the Frozen Isles. As I suspected, after talking to my fellow searcher in the swamp town, there's no sign of any part of the legend around these frozen woods. We searched the snowy wild for many hours, but there was little more than ice to be found gleaming in the sun. After being denied entrance to Castle Dragontooth on account of prior dealings with our healer Effa, we decided to camp in the frozen woods of these isles and keep fire watch, which is what I do as I write this. I've had more comfortable nights, but there's no hard feelings toward Rafa. It is, after all, much easier crossing the ocean with the use of our ghostly ship. I will mask this scrope as we part ways in Fountainhead, but there are other things that call me. This has been but a tool for me, and my real search is not for legends and lore, but my nemesis Shelton. From the very beginning, he has seen these isles, and all that lives upon them is his enemy. And twice he's planned their extinction. Now that this isles have rested in the gates of Terra, I'm sure he's not given up his crusade to destroy them. I know not what his plan has set into motion, but I see that his work is always chaotic. I've been making these notes as a record to leave behind for any who will join me in my search for Shelton and his evil plot. I believe the ancient pyramids play into his schemes, and that is where I will begin my search. When I set out again, this time I'll go alone. But to any who will follow, I will leave clues to give the benefit of the new information I uncover. I've not told others of this, but in the ruins of Castle Blackwind, back in the Isle of Illusion, I found a message among the rubble that may shed light on the mystery of Shelton's scheme. It seems to place much importance on the three manners of men we have come to call alignment, good, neutral, and evil. For many years, there's been peace among these different attitudes, but it's not always been so. There was once many wars fought over differences of these three alignments, and perhaps it is Shelton's plan to rekindle this ancient rivalry. I'm still working on what may be the meaning of this message in the rubble. In the land today, the question of good and evil is resolved in response to certain situations. There are certain enchanted areas where one or the other may not be welcome. But there is little chance of war fueled by the differences being started in these times of enlightenment. Nevertheless, I am sure the subtle differences of these three, good, neutral, and evil, play into the schemes of Shelton. I'll stop writing for tonight. Asa will soon come to relieve me of my watch. It's been a pleasant trek across the isles with this group, pleasant save for the death of Rafa. Thank the forces of the monks, the temples can lift the conditions of ill inevitably befall the adventurer. Be you cursed, paralyzed, or even eradicated, there's always a remedy and a price to be found at the temples. With the coming of the morning light, we will start our final journey to Fountainhead, and from there I will once again set out alone. My feelings are echoed in the cries of the wolves I hear floating across the moonlit sky. After passing through Leopard Canyon, we reached Fountainhead late into the day. I parted company with my group at the inn, where they immediately found another young adventurer anxious to join them on their next excursion. Of course, after they spent some time in the tavern to recuperate. Before I start my search for Shelton, there are a few final pieces of advice I'd like to offer to those who follow me into the mystery. There are skills that will be very helpful, if not completely necessary, in your travels across the isles. You must find their masters to teach them and you, and prepare to pay the price. Here are some of the more helpful skills: cartography, danger sense, detect secret passages, mountaineering, pathfinding, and swimming. And always keep a full spellbook. When you have mastered the spells you know to such a degree, you are prepared to learn others, gain membership to guild, and learn what you can. Seek the wandering mages who sell these memberships. The price is small to pay to have the right incantation when needed. If you gain a spell from an enchanted pool or buy it from a traveling teacher and have no explanation of its use, go to one of the guilds for a description. Remember, to keep a good supply of gems, as some spells require the power locked within the crystals. These are the spells available to the novice in the ways of magic. Awaken, detect magic, elemental arrow, first aid, flying fist, and holy shit light. And when all hope is gone, be it in the face of great dragon or surrounded by too many orcs to dispatch, you may call upon the benevolent hand of Mr. Wizard to carry you back to safety. He will always answer the call for help, but be warned, he will also extract the toll of experience from those he rescues. In other words, don't ever use that shit. A mighty warrior can soon be rendered weak if he calls for the help of the wizard too often. It's best to resolve a situation without his help, if any solution exists. But new adventurers find favor in the heart of Mr. Wizard, and those he will help without fee. Now I must prepare for my search for Seltum. Take these notes and use them as you discover his schemes. And together we may be able to thwart his plot. Search for the clues I leave behind, and good luck to you on your journey. And may the powers of might and magic be always at your side.